Hey guys, welcome back to the fifth video in this flame game development series where we are making Ski Master, a top-down vertical scroller about skiing. In the last video, we added a player component that is responsible for all the player movement logic. We also added an input component that takes care of handling all the keyboard inputs. And with the help of these two components, we managed to get a controllable player character in the game. So in this video, we are going to spawn in some snowmen along the skiing trail which the player can collect by running into them. And to do that, we'll first have to mark the locations on the tile map where each snowman will be spawned. So let's open up our tile project. Right now, we have two tile layers in our map. But to mark spawn points on the map, we'll have to create an object layer. I'll name this layer as spawn point. Notice that when an object layer is active, all the normal tile painting tools get disabled and all the object placement tools get activated. Using these tools, we can mark rectangles, points, circles, and polygons on the map. But none of these will actually render anything when the map is loaded in Flame. They are just stored as metadata in the map that can be accessed through the code to spawn some game objects. So here, I'll use the point tool and place a point at the start of the trail. I'll use this as the spawn point for the player character. And since there can be multiple spawn points on the map for different objects, I'll set the class property of this object as player to distinctly identify it from the rest. Later, we'll read this property in the code and place the player at the coordinates of this point. You can also set an optional name for this object. I'll displace this name on top of the object so that you can visually tell which object represents what without having to look at its class property. Next, to mark the spawn location of snowmen, I'll use the insert tile tool. Technically, this is sort of similar to the rectangle tool with the added benefit of being able to display a tile on the map. I could have used the point tool for this as well, but I just wanted to showcase multiple ways of storing data in object layer. So once this tool is active, you just have to select a tile from the tile set and then place it on the map. And like I said earlier, this will not automatically render the snowman tile in the game. We'll still have to read the object data and spawn it ourselves. And similar to the player start, I'll set the class property of this object as snowman. Now let's just duplicate this object a couple more times and place them along the trail. And once I'm done, I'll re-export this level as level1.tmx. Now back in the code, we can start reading the new data from the tile map. So let's go to the onload of gameplay class. Here, we can get hold of the object layer by calling getLayer on the tile map of the loaded tiled component. This method needs name of the layer as input and the type of the layer as the generic type. So I'll use spawn point for the layer name and object group as the generic type. For some reason, the tile dart package chose to use object group to represent object layer. So we'll have to live with that. Next, I'll try to get the list of objects from this spawn point layer if it is not null. And if the objects list is not null, I'll loop through each object of this list. Inside the loop, I'll switch over class of the object. Here, class is of string type and its value represents the class that we defined in the editor. So here, I'll add case for player and snowman. Next, let's move the player creation code inside the first case. I'll also move the world creation code so that the world is created before we start spawning the player. And since the player is not created at this point, I'll remove the player from world's children list. Now in the player constructor, we can use the x and y coordinates from the object as player's position. Then I'll add the player to the world. Next, we'll also have to move the camera setup to happen before the player is created so that this camera.followPlayer can be moved inside the switch case. Now let's quickly run this and check if the player is spawning at the correct location. And yep, it seems to be working just fine. Okay. So next, let's implement the case for snowman. Here, I'll create a new sprite component with its position set as objects x and y coordinates. For the sprite, we need the snowman sprite from the image asset. In the last video, we already created a sprite sheet object from the image in the player class So let's do some refactoring of this code so that we can use a common sprite sheet for player and snowman. First, I'll move the sprite sheet creation code from player to gameplay. I'll put it just before we start reading the spawn point layer. To make this work, we'll need to add the hasGame reference mixin to this class. And let's also quickly add the import for sprite sheet. Then next, in the player class, I'll add a required sprite parameter to the constructor. That way, we'll be able to create the body right when the player is getting constructed, and the body won't have to be marked as late. So this fixes the player class. Then in the gameplay class, we'll just have to set the sprite parameter for the player using the sprite sheet. And now we can use the same sprite sheet to get the sprite for snowman as well. I'll just change the column from 10 to 9 here, and then I'll add the snowman to the world. Now let's hot restart the game and check if this is working. Okay, and as you can see, a snowman is visible in the game now. But if you look carefully, you'll notice that the snowman is placed at a slight offset from the original position. If I go back to tiled, you can see that the first snowman is placed at the same level as this nearby bush. But in the game, it has shifted down by one tile. This happened because, by default, tile stores the coordinates of bottom left corner of the tile in the object. But our code expects it to be the top left corner. So to fix this, we can go back to the tiled editor and open the tile set of this map. Here, under the tile set properties, there is an option called object alignment. Setting this to top left will ideally solve the problem. But I want the snowman to be centered around the position. So I'll set this to center and save this file. Now if I go back to the tile map, you can see that all the snowman objects are centered around their original position. So I'll just quickly adjust them a little bit. Also, I forgot to mention, you can change the snapping options under view to have more control over the object placement. Okay, and I'll have to again re-export the map to see these changes in the game. And back in the code, we'll just have to set the anchor of the snowman to anchor.center. Now if I restart the game, you can see that the snowman components are placed at the correct locations. Okay, now let's make the snowman collectible. For that, we'll need to create a snowman component and move the sprite component in that class. But first, let's create an actor folder under the game folder and move the player.dart file here. This folder will store all the movable and interactable objects. In here, let's create a new file called snowman.dart. This file will contain the snowman class, which will extend the position component. Snowman class will be somewhat similar to the player class. So I'll just copy over the constructor and onload method from player into this class. And now that we have the snowman class ready, let's go back to the gameplay class and replace the sprite component with snowman. And this anchor parameter can be removed from here, because snowman now internally handles centering of the sprite component. If I run the game now, everything should still look the same. Okay, now to make the player interact with the snowman, we'll have to set up some hitboxes for these components. Hitboxes are part of the built-in collision detection system of Flame. Basically, a hitbox defines the collidable area for a component. And when two hitboxes intersect with each other, Flame invokes some callback methods on the components to let them handle and resolve the collision. So in the onload of the player class, I'll add a circle hitbox to the player. Flame also supports rectangle hitbox and polygon hitbox, which we'll use in the future videos. But for the player and snowman, circle hitbox is fine. Now this circle hitbox is essentially a component, and it has a radius parameter to control its size. But if we don't set the radius, the hitbox will automatically expand to be as big as the component to which it is attached. This is exactly what we want, but the problem is we are attaching the hitbox directly to the player, which in this case is a position component with zero size. And the size that we want actually comes from the player's body component. So to make the hitbox as big as the body, I'll use the dot relative constructor of circle hitbox. The first parameter to this constructor is a fraction from 0 to 1 that defines the relation between hitbox's size and the parent size. I'll keep it as 1, indicating the hitbox should be as big as the parent size. Then for the parent size parameter, I'll use body.size. And finally, I'll set the anchor of this hitbox as anchor.center. I'll quickly set the debug mode for this hitbox as true to show how it looks in the game. And as you can see, now there is a circular hitbox around the player. Okay, now let's add a similar hitbox to the snowman component as well. The only difference is that I'll set the collision type for this hitbox as collision type.passive. By default, the collision type for all hitboxes is active. This means flame performs collision checks between all of them. But in many cases, we are not interested in all those collisions. For example, in this case, we are not interested in collisions between two snowman components. In fact, we are pretty sure that they will never collide in this game. Collision type for such hitboxes can be set to passive. This way, flame will skip checking collisions between passive hitboxes. Based on the game, this can greatly reduce the amount of computations flame has to do behind the scenes. Okay, now to make flame actually perform the collision detection, we'll need to add the has collision detection mixin to our flame game class. Next, to allow flame to be able to notify the player about collisions, we need to add the collision callbacks mixin to the player class. Adding this mixin allows us to override various onCollision methods. And the one we are interested in here is the onCollisionStart method. This method gets invoked at the start of each collision. As input to this method, we get the set of points where the two hitboxes intersect, and we also get a reference to the other component with which our component has collided. And since the other component can be any of the valid collidable components, I'll check if it is of snowman type. If this check passes, we can simply call remove from parent on the other component. This will remove the colliding snowman from the component tree and eventually destroy it from the memory as well. Now let's save this and test the game. And as you can see, now the snowman disappears when the player collides with it. Although this is functionally working, the sudden disappearance of snowman does not look too good. So to allow the snowman to gradually disappear from the game, let's add a public method to it called collect. And in the onCollisionStart of the player class, let's call this collect method instead of directly removing the component. Now back in the collect method, I'll make the snowman fade out by adding an opacity effect. I'll use the fade out constructor with the controller parameter set to linear effect controller. Here we can define the duration of the effect in seconds. So let's set this to 0.4. Now when we add an effect to a component, it generally targets the same component. This means this opacity effect will target the snowman component. But technically, opacity effect can only be applied to components that expose a paint object and have some visual element. In our case, snowman is just a position component without any paint. So to make this opacity effect target the sprite component of the snowman, I'll set its target parameter as body. And finally, I'll set the onComplete of this effect to invoke the removeFromParent method of snowman. This will ensure that the component gets removed from the tree as soon as the effect completes. Now let's test this in the game. And as you can see, the snowman now gradually fades away when it collides with the player. If you want, you can play around with multiple effects and get some complex behavior. For example, I'll convert this to add all so that I can add a list of effects to the snowman. Then I'll add a scale effect to the list which uniformly scales the snowman by a factor of 1.2 over the same duration as the opacity effect. Now if I test this in the game, you can see that the snowman nicely scales and fades out when it gets collected. So yeah, that brings us to the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed it and learned something new. If you did, make sure to hit that like button. Maybe consider subscribing to show your support, and I'll see you in the next one.